to welcome you to worship at Mount Vernon Community Presbyterian Church. It's wonderful to see you all here. My guess is you don't have heat at home. We're glad that you're here soaking up our heat here. Just a few announcements. We have soup for sale on February 13th and hoagies. The soup goes to the kitchen renovation. The hoagies go to send kids to camp at Crestfield. They can further delve into their faith, experience God in different ways. So if you would like to support the youth going on a trip and not have to make lunch for yourself, February 13th, please be down there. A note of sadness, Bill Craig has passed away. I'm sure many of you knew him, having run the funeral home for so many years. Jim Craig's brother as well. So prayers for the Craig family as they go through this difficult time. There's a lot of other announcements. You know, every Thursday at 11 o'clock we have a Bible study. We're going to be going through Philippians coming up. Everybody's welcome. Bring a friend. If you're in school, just skip it and come to Bible study. I'll write you a note. Pastor said it's okay. We'll see what happens. We can make the news together. With all that said, let us worship the living and the loving God.
Can you all join me for a call to worship? How blessed we are that God forgives us and loves us.
All of his times we have fallen short, but our God has passed faith, and we have been forgiven.
God makes us new in God's Spirit.
Let us open our hearts to the peace and joy of God. Amen.
which breaks down. We confess to you our part in those things, and in humility and hope, we ask for your help to do better, to forgive, to heal, to soothe, to build up, so we may love you and your neighbor and follow our Christ. In whose name we pray.
Hear the good news. The mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting. Let us proclaim the good news.
Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. All right, I'd like to welcome the children up for the children's message. The children, I'd like to come out and learn about forgiveness. Take your time. He said, not really. That's okay. All right, Phil. Got some special music then.
It's special music, but you all can join me. Please stand and sing River of Life and Power on the Foot. If you want, maybe you stand up and sing.
Open prison doors.
Please be seated. Is that written by a guy from Pittsburgh?
Power.
I'm a tall Pittsburgh. That's perfectly my word.
All right, well, let's get ready to listen to me stumble over normal words. Today's gospel reading is Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50. Listen and hear the word of the Lord. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house, reclined at the table. A woman in that town who had lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. The Pharisees who had invited him saw this. He said to himself, "This man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him, what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher." "Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave both debts. Which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt. Forgive him." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little, loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. One day, during Sunday school, the Sunday school teacher was over and over trying to explain the concept of forgiveness to the young children. She said, "All you have to do is ask Jesus for forgiveness and you get forgiveness." "That's it," the kids said. "That's it. All you have to do is ask Jesus for forgiveness and you're forgiven." Well, the pastor was walking by and the Sunday school teacher said, "Come on in. I want you to hear this." She said, "Children, what's the one thing we need to get forgiveness?" And Johnny had backed it up and said, "Well, you have to sin first." Let's talk about our sin today. God's forgiveness. Let us pray. Gracious God, my words are your words. Let them enter our hearts and minds. If my words are not your words, let them be quickly forgotten, like seed on the hard ground, blown to the wind. Amen. We continue our series on church words, things that you've heard since you were growing up, or if you're new to the church, that you hear, but maybe haven't delved into a little bit. We've talked about grace, we've talked about reconciliation. Today, we're going to talk about forgiveness. Forgiveness. It's a word that we hear in church all the time. Jesus died for your sins. You are forgiven because of what Jesus has done. And all that is required for us to have our sins forgiven is to ask. We simply must ask God for forgiveness of our sin. Now, this seems easy enough, but we all know this isn't exactly the easiest thing. Many of us run into one of two problems. The first is we don't take our sin very serious. I think it's because we don't understand or think about the cost of sin. Make no mistake, friends, the cost for forgiveness was the blood of Jesus Christ. That's why we should take each sin serious. We shouldn't treat it like a bad diet. You know? Hey, I already ate a brownie, so my diet's broken. I might as well eat the next 3 pans of brownies. We can't treat our sin like an afterthought. We can't, and I've done this numerous times. I'm tired, and I decide to pray at the end of the day, and I say, hey, God, forgive me for the things I did wrong. You know what I'm talking about. I mean, imagine if your coworker or neighbor continually said terrible things about you, treated you poorly day after day after day, and then one day they walked up and said, hey, I'm sorry, and then walked away. I mean, it's better than nothing, but sorry for what? How do I know you're not going to do it again? Because it seems like you might. Sin requires the blood of Christ. We need to take accountability for our sins. If we want true forgiveness, we need to ask God for the forgiveness of that sin. It's your best chance to not continually repeating that sin. It's taking accountability of each time you walk away from God. Now, our other big problem is we don't always receive forgiveness well. Sometimes it's guilt, sometimes it's pride. There's a vulnerability to getting forgiveness, whether it's from God or from someone else. There's a humility that must be present when receiving forgiveness. We didn't always do humility really well. Phil, I forgive you. See? No reaction at all. It's just... We all think in our heads, oh, I'd love to get forgiveness from somebody. But then, we have to take stock of what we've done in that broken relationship. It's not always what we want. I'm reminded of a story some years ago. I was supporting a friend in an AA meeting, and I was sitting there with him, and they had to tell stories of why they got arrested. And to be honest with you, a lot of the stories were kind of just mundane. They were out and about drinking too much. So it gets to this one man. So I was driving my car one day after drinking all day at a bar, and I live up in Amish country. I was swerving a little bit, and the buggy's supposed to have reflectors because they won't use lights, and it didn't have it, and I hit a buggy, 70 miles an hour. And I took the life of a young man and his pregnant wife. The man said when he went to court, the entire Amish community was outside praying with him and some inside the court. What they wanted was to let him know that he was forgiven. Forgiven for that act. Think of how powerful that is. The man mentioned he was going to take his life. But how could he after receiving such an amazing gift of forgiveness? How could he do that? Now, we should take our cues from Jesus. Jesus forgives us from the sins that require his death. I think we can forgive others, seeing that they're probably a little more petty. Now, this is the part I want you to pay attention to, because I get this question more than almost any other question. I'm going to explain to you why we say debts, and the Catholics say trespasses, okay? So pay attention, I don't want to go over this again. Now, first question, who's right? Well, us, of course. Jesus spoke in Aramaic. They wrote in Hebrew. So even the disciples had to translate Jesus' language. Now we have 2 passages with the Lord's Prayer. One in Matthew, one in Luke. The Aramaic word is choba. Matthew translates it debts. Luke translates it trespasses. So why the different translations? Different scholars think different things. And here's the best that I've seen. And I know this, I'm pretty sure that this is the where it lands. Matthew is writing to a Jewish audience. He was a disciple of Jesus, but he was writing to the Jewish people to try to persuade them to understand that Jesus was the Messiah. So he translates it debts. It's something that's owed to God. It requires a payment, a sacrifice. This is the thinking that would work well for his audience. Luke was writing to Gentiles, everybody else. He uses trespasses. It's walking in sin. If you see a no trespassing sign, are you allowed to walk in there? No, you're doing something that you shouldn't be doing. You're walking in a place that you're not meant to walk. You're not supposed to be there. Trespasses. You're walking where you don't belong. Because you were made to walk in God. You're trespassing, you're walking in sin. Now, if you're not sure about this, let's all just run on the violet form tonight and see what happens. Now, we've talked about receiving God's forgiveness, being humble enough to receive others. Let's talk about forgiving others. What is it that keeps us from forgiving other people? Rationally, we know it's a good thing to do. Jesus tells us it's a great, great thing to do. And we even know it'll be good for us to forgive others. So what is it that stops us from doing it? Because I got to tell you, I don't know that we can take our faith and our relationship with God seriously if we're withholding forgiveness from others. I'm not sure we can read the gospel, see what Jesus did, and respond in a way that withholds forgiveness from others after Jesus has forgiven everyone. I'm not sure that you can have both. Now, I get it. Like, my family's German. We're a stubborn people. I have a great aunt and uncle who live next to each other who haven't talked in 50 years over an argument about who sang a song on the radio. So, yeah, we're pretty good. Forgiveness is one of the greatest gifts, if not the greatest gift, we can give to not only ourselves, but to someone else. I've heard a preacher put it this way. We are most like beasts when we kill. We are most like men when we judge. We are most like God when we forgive. We are most like God when we forgive. You know, giving forgiveness is a godly act. It's a godly act. We can talk and try to convince others that they should be Christians or follow Jesus and tell them it's good for them. And all of those words, I mean, they just won't compare to a powerful act of forgiveness. Powerful act of forgiveness. And I can see it in your eyes, and I know it, and I have that too. There's just this one person. I just can't forgive. I just can't do it. But I have to ask you, what's stopping you? Do you see that as a godly act? A godly act. And I know, you were right and they were wrong. I'll tell it to my aunt and my uncle. What is this? Is it our pride? What is stopping us from doing this godly act? The power of forgiveness is immeasurable. It makes a statement to everybody in the world, I'm doing what my Savior did for me. But Jesus didn't hold back with us. How can we possibly hold back for others? Forgiveness against the debts they owe you. Forgiveness against their trespasses, where they walked all over you, where they walked where you told them not to walk. Forgiveness, it's godly. It's immeasurable. It doesn't make any sense. It's above everything this world will tell you. I'm going to finish with this one story.
I used to serve at a church in San Antonio, downtown San Antonio. It was a really big church, a couple thousand people. And my boss suggested to me to join a men's fellowship group. Well, since my boss recommended it, I figured I should be eagerly enjoying this. So I joined it, and for 1 year, you and another man were supposed to meet like every 2 weeks for breakfast and go through this book. I don't know the name of it, it was orange. It looked like my daughter's opera book. It said discipleship on the front. I got paired with a retired banker named Frank. One of the sweetest, nicest guys I've ever met in my life. After meeting for a while, and he had mentioned that he was divorced before, or not divorced, he had a wife, he decided to tell me this story. He was the president of a bank. One day, the kidnappers came to his house, took his wife, called him, and said, if we don't get a ransom, we're gonna take your wife's life. He rushed to transfer the money. Something went wrong. They took her life. They were convicted, sentenced to jail, and camera crews actually came to Frank's house. See, we should have been hating the media all along. They came to his house. They were excited to hear him talk about his anger, talk about how much he hated these men. Instead, Frank looked the camera in the eye, and he said, I'm glad that he did the death penalty. I want these men know Jesus Christ. I'm glad justice is being served, but I forgive him. Friends, forgiveness is godly work. We need to ask God for forgiveness, humble ourselves to receive it from others, but we need to forgive others. When we can forgive, especially people we really don't want to, when we can give that forgiveness to somebody, what we're really doing is proclaiming the presence of Jesus Christ in the world. Because forgiveness outside of Christ doesn't make sense. Because it's a godly act. So when we forgive others, we are doing godly things, and pointing right to Jesus Christ in the midst of all. Amen.
Outside of the comfort zone, I'm making you sing an extra song today. So you understand I'm saying I'm going to be a Christian for a while.
We will walk hand in hand.
Trespassers paid, Stacy.
God the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Gracious God, bless these gifts in the hearts and hands of the kingdom. Give us the wisdom, strength, use them well to proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. Unity, our country, and our world. Community that we have in the Holy Spirit today and every day. Amen.